Amen.
Jesus is love. I know. And if you ask, I'm so. Love is no more.
your word, God, Father God. Lord, we just want to thank you for your messenger that will bring your word on today, Father God. Use him as a mighty willing vessel, Father God. Lord, that you need to guide us and strength and build us over the torn down. Bless the ones that are under the sound of my voice and the ones that are not under the sound of my voice, Father God. Lord, we want to lift up the Jones family to you, Father God. Lord, we want to lift up the aliens. Now, Lord, we know you are a healer. But you said this morning you are a healer. And people all do is call on you, Father God. And Lord, we just want to thank you for being a healer. Thank you for being delivered, Father God. Just thank you for being God all by yourself, Father God. Lord, we ask you to just continue to bless each and every family, Father God. Lift them up in the name of Jesus, Father God. Whatever they need, Father God. Lord, we ask you to answer their prayer, Father God. And Lord, we just want to thank you for your son who died on the cross, that we might have life and have it more abundantly, Father God. Lord, we ask that you will continue to guide us and strengthen us. Thank you for raising up on the third day with all power in his hand, Father God. Lord, we just want to say thank you, Father God. If we had 10,000 tongues, we would say thank you enough. But we just want to thank you for the one that we have, Father God. And Lord, we ask you to bless the 6 o'clock service, Father God, that our speaker would just hear from you and give us exactly what we need, Father God. And Lord, we know you will, because you have been delivering all the time, Father God. And thank you for being our own kind, God, Father God. Lord, we ask you to continue to get us in prison. Me and the summer, we're torn down, Father God. Lord, we ask you to bless all churches that's down within your name, Father God. Lord, bless the members of your body, Father God. Continue to guide us and strengthen us, Father God. And never leave us alone, Father God. Lord, continue to guide us and strengthen us, and keep us on our way, and never leave us alone. Believe in the confession. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, we would like anybody who doesn't have their phone muted to do us a courtesy and please mute your phone so everybody can hear and get the word and the prayer even. Let's be thoughtful of one another in all that we do. Amen?
Amen.
Today's sermon is called Slaying Your Goliaths. And we all know the story of David and Goliath, where the shepherd boy comes up and slays this large man. How his brothers thought he was conceited and did not realize that their brother was just truly confident in God and the God that he served. And in his Lord's abilities, he wasn't bragging on himself. He was actually confident in what the Lord can do. And when you look at this, you see that David stepped to a situation, a problem that we all have. We all have some form of a Goliath. So my verses today come from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 46 through 47, and verse 49, and I even threw 48 in a little later, but those three verses start us off, and it reads as follows. 1 Samuel 17, 46 through 47, and verse 49. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God of Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Verse 49, reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell face down on the ground. Now, we know Goliath here was a big man. He was about 9 feet 3 inches to 11 feet 9 inches, and it tells you how big this man was in verse 4 of this chapter. Goliath may have been or had some Anakim blood in him, who were a tall people, and you can see that in the book of Deuteronomy in chapter 2. But more importantly, Goliath was a large problem that the army slash men were trying to handle alone. And you notice I said they were trying to handle it alone. And as you see, we see David's rock. This rock. And this wasn't no particular rock. It was just this rock was the instrument that took down Goliath. But it was his faith that slayed Goliath. Remember what the Lord says about faith of a mustard seed? If you look at Matthew 17, 20, he replied, "Because you have so little faith, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to the mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you." Now remember, in this verse, he said a mustard seed, not a watermelon. So the Lord is saying that he will do much with very little. And let me put this another way, and we will know that it is football season. And I hate to say this because my sister on the phone. If the Pittsburgh Steelers had the faith of a mustard seed, they would be the New England Patriots. Don't comment. And so if you look at this, we really saying, who is doing the work here? Who can do the work here? Our problem is to step in faith. See, it tells you in verse 47, it says, "All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves." See, the Lord didn't save them by sword or spear. He really saved them by faith. And this battle was the Lord's. All you have to do is have some faith. And God will put it in your hands. He will give it to you. So look at Job's Goliath. And I like Job because he had a job, and that was to stay faithful and prove the devil wrong. Think of the story of Job, where Satan basically says that the only reason Job loves you is because of all the blessings that he is receiving. Now remember this before I go ahead with the story. Job 1 and 7 said, "The Lord said to Satan, where have you come from? Satan answered the Lord, from roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." So just to let you know that Satan is here to be your Goliath. So plan to suffer, plan to have some problems. And if Satan doesn't mean anything else, his actions mean the suffering, persecution, and destruction of anyone trying to be a child of God. He's one of your Goliaths. In short, the Lord let Job be tested, and this was a great time for Job to start whining and complaining and fussing, because look at what Job lost. See, Job went against the grain, because when you have everything, it is hard for most to call on the Lord, because this world is going in your favor. Things are going your way. But Job was faithfully enduring, an enduring person. The devil was not allowed to lay a hand on him, but he could put Job to the test. Job was left with nothing, and he didn't whine. As a matter of fact, he started winning, because Job was aware of who gave him everything, and he praised the Lord. He praised him during his suffering. He praised him during his loss. Job's Goliath, which Satan thought he was going to be, was being defeated by Job staying true to his faith. Job had a lot, and even with the losses that he received, he called on God and did not sin by saying anything against God. And don't forget, Job had some Goliaths in his friends. Job had a Goliath in his wife. But Job stayed true to the one true God. Job praised God for all trials and tribulations, because perseverance increases faith. We have to remember that God has the right to do as he wills, and Job knew this and stayed strong. He had an opportunity to whine, but instead he said that I'm staying with the Lord and his will, and I am sticking with the promises. So, did you see the victory that he received here in more abundance? But his earthly possession, even the lack of, didn't stop him from winning. When he could have broken down and said, Lord, I have been doing the right things. I have been praising you and worshiping you. And these bad things are not happening to other people. Job knew about his victory and there was no need to whine because he knew that even with the loss that he suffered here, he had a bigger treasure elsewhere. And when you have the victory, then there is no need to be whining about this world. There's no need. Let's look at Jesus in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4. Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit to be tempted by the devil. A Goliath situation. We can't walk on water. This was after he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Physically exhausted. Another Goliath in this situation. Getting ready to be tested by a spiritual Goliath. And then the temptations that Satan stated to a physically weak, or so this Goliath thought. And Satan also thought that physical weakness would lead to some spiritual weakness. But he didn't know Jesus had a pocket full of rocks that had so much faith on him that when the word of God hit Satan, Satan was trying to figure out, how did the script get switched? How did the opportunity for a Goliath moment fade away that fast? And now I have to run because the word of God and the faith are dropping these rocks on me left and right. That Goliath slayer is working in your faith. When you call on the Lord and trust in the Lord, he will protect you. Do you know this man that goes into battle against the Goliath and cowers because you aren't strong enough to handle that problem? You know when you have to fight that enemy called your tongue. We never take the battle to our mouths because we have never been able to control it, so we just let it get bigger and bigger. It spits out pride, criticism, anger, vulgarity, hatred, animosity, racism, and more poisonous conversations, and then it turns around and tries to fill me with love. How does that work? I wish I had David's rock so I could pop you in your mouth right now because it is the largest Goliath that I have seen. Its size is enormous because it populates the earth and its time is from the beginning and we still won't call on God to subdue it for us. The truth of the matter is that David's rocks could not take down that Goliath of a tongue because David's rocks did not take down Goliath. The object that took down Goliath and the object can take down the tongue is the faith that David had in God that took down Goliath. Think about your financial situations and how you keep trying to fix them yourself, but you haven't prayed on it truthfully. You may have told the Lord that you need more money to cover these bills, but have you asked him to help you defeat your spending habits? Goliath. And your lust for material things, Goliath. And the things that your flesh desires, Goliath. Have you stepped out on faith and been faithful with your offerings, knowing that God has already been fighting your battles? If he'll fight your spiritual battles, he'll come and help you with your material battles. Maybe you need to sit down and brag about how God has carried you through to some believers as well as unbelievers. Ask David about how he was carried through with a little rock and a little bit of faith. Think about the things that drag you down in this world, and let me start with this killing thing. We have not been able to battle this flesh alone ever. We have been weak from sexual morality to physical destruction of God's children. Our hearts are in a place where you can't change it and your mind is cluttered with the wrong things. This world is filling you up like a glass, and now you overflowing with nothing but the world. You don't call on the Lord to empty you out and fill you up with the Spirit. See, the Lord can fight that battle for you, and the Lord can get the heart right. And God can clean up that mind. But you have to let God fight your battle and sit down and let God be God. Exodus 14 and 14 tells you, the Lord will fight for you. You need only be still. Do you have the faith to turn your Goliath over to God and then be still and let God be God? One of the things we got to fight a lot of is our emotions. We struggle with our anger, our hatred. The way that we feel inside that we express outside, and sometimes our expressions of our emotions are harmful and hurtful. Do we ask God to take us out of a bad relationship, and then we get out of a bad one and he gives you a good one, but you still stuck in your bad one, that you go back to the Goliath problem you had when the Lord already gave you the rocks to get out of that Goliath situation? See, this is all a faith thing. David didn't pick up those rocks alone thinking that they would stop his Goliath. Don't you try to do it alone thinking you're going to stop your Goliath. He picked them up in faith, knowing God's abilities. You are in a world that has forces that you can't fight alone. And sometimes those unseen and eternal forces can be the most destructive. Well, if I can't see them, then I want to battle them with something or someone that handles the unseen. And your Bible already tells you what that is, Hebrews 11 and 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So I know that there are things unseen. I know that there are things that aren't tangible to me that are working against me. And my faith in God is who I go to handle these things. What about that? I have to be the center of attention spirit. And I want to call it exactly what it is. I have to be seen. I have to be heard. They need to acknowledge my presence and existence. And they better know that I am closer to God than anyone else. You know that we have that in God's church because you think that it is your church. I can't be taught something because I know everything. And you can't tell me anything because I only want to tell you things. See, that is a spirit that destroys. And first, excuse me, I didn't want to call it arrogance or conceit because it needed to be broken down. If you have that spirit, then you might need to get hit with a bunch of rocks because you are battling the flesh and its destructive ways. You might need to let the Lord intercede and change your mind and your heart because your Goliath is not just hurting you, but it is leading people to having their own Goliath. And starting to grow in them because they know that you are coming and they are ducking out of the way and their thoughts are escaping them because you are pushing a force at them that should not be coming from a child of God. You are pushing your Goliath into someone else's life and giving them an additional battle that you inflicted. Don't think that you can't push your Goliath on somebody else. False doctrine is a Goliath on somebody else. Lying is a Goliath on somebody else. Coveting is a Goliath you push on somebody else. So turn yourself over to God and let God get the true attention that is deserved, that is rightfully His, and step back and be humble, rejoicing as a child of God, just being able to share in His word. It is not about us. It always was and always will be about Jesus. The last Goliath that I want to address is the political atmosphere that we are facing today. We have your president saying sexual harassment claims that can't be true because he knows his selectees is high quality people. We have former presidents who got an ego that are larger than life that are looking to run right back into that position. And if you watch the world kind of finds it favorable if they get back in that position. We have presidents that want to be, who have a Goliath that's an ego. The reason why everyone and anyone should be skeptical of this selection is because of the track record. Look at all the employees that have resigned and left and moved around. If you watch your political views, you can see these changes. And guess what? They hire exactly what they need. They don't work for what the people need. They go to what they need. And it talks to their character. But an example that I will use is that these priests, pastors, ministers, and everyone else that are being caught up with these young men are being hired by people that have the same actions in their minds, and some bring it to fruition. If you don't believe it, you can look at former President Trump. He hired exactly who he is. And if I was David fighting that Goliath, then I would have picked up a mountain and then asked the Lord to put as much stank on it as possible and threw it at him. But don't be fooled. The world is still looking for this man and his ways and his characters to come back. Anyone that tells you they don't have to repent because they have never sinned, they got a Goliath on their shoulder. Now, when we get back to David, you can remember that these men were in army attire with better weapons than David, but their weapons were man-made and they didn't contain any faith because they were scared. David's rocks were nothing special, but his faith was. Have you looked at your faith yet? Are you still trying to use man's weapon instead of God's weapons? See, David bragged about his God and for what he had done for him and what he had carried him through. And if you even look at 1 Samuel 17, 34 through 37, David says, but David said to Saul, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock. I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defiled the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. If the Lord rescued David from a lion, a bear, a Philistine, and we know David had some ways about him, but we ain't perfect and neither was David. If you go to him in faith, he will rescue you. See, David was told that he was a young boy by Saul, but God does not work by age. He works by faith. And can you imagine the faith that David had to fight a bear and a lion? So why fear this Goliath when God has been fighting your battles? Whatever your Goliath may be, it could be drug addiction, it could be alcohol, it could be womanism, manism, it could be anything. Have you given it to the Goliath slayer? See, David went out there with blood and confident faith, knowing that this was not his first battle, and this is not your first battle. So why ain't you going out there with confidence? Because when he went out to battle, David had already turned it over to the Lord. Don't go out to the battle and try to get on the front line. Go to the battle knowing that God is on the front line. And you are following by faith. This means that You should go out there confident and bold, knowing that this isn't the first battle that the Lord has fought for you when your faith is right. Remember that this world will curse you with its gods for money to unscrupulous acts, but be ready to see what happens when you have a God that can defeat these Goliaths. Because don't forget that Goliath cursed David with his gods. And when David struck Goliath down, he did it with the faith in the one and only God. David didn't need to put on things that Saul offered him. No tunic, no bows and arrows, no spears or anything of the like. David had to put on the full armor of God. But you can only put it on when you are strong in the Lord, and then you can stand against your Goliath because you're with God and dressed by God. David went out there in confidence. He didn't need man's weapon. He needed faith in God. See, God has fought our battles that you were not even aware of, and God is always victorious. He has never lost. You can do like David did and run up to your Goliath and claim the victory. You know, if you stop drinking, if you stop smoking, whatever it may be, go claim it in confidence after you gave it to God. And stand over it and say, I serve a mighty God that will fight all of my battles if I just have a little faith. And even if the victory is not mine here by faith, I know that it has already been done because my Jesus defeated this world. Sin and death, and Jesus is the doorway to my eternal victory. That salvation is your victory. So you can defeat your Goliath no matter what it is. I left out verse 48 intentionally. See, it says, as the Philistines moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. David was working in total faith. While everybody else cowered and were fearful, David went to it. We are in a world where there is so much Goliath, from media to television to what our children hear and see to what can come across a cell phone, that we have to run out there in total faith and confidence and meet it on that battle line. That is saying, in order to defeat your Goliath and show your faith, don't be scared, because God is there when you have faith. And when you have faith, you have the victory. We can do all the things and everything with God when you face your Goliaths. Run to them because you are backed and protected by the Most High and by faith. So pick up your rocks and go slay your Goliaths. Amen.
Amen, my brother. Amen. What a word. Amen. I just want to ask a question to everyone on here today. What is our God? What stands in our God? That we think that we can't defeat. You know, we always telling people, we're telling our people about our problems. We're gonna start telling our problems about how big our God is. So what is our Goliath? What's standing in our way from stepping out?
Personal being.
Amen. 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 We hear you, brother.
That's alive.
Yes, sir.
Surprise you, didn't it?
You surprised us.
I surprised you. Well, I'm coming base playing Mississippi. I'm finished. A playmate of mine, I came to share the word of the gospel with her on this day. This was my spirit leading me. And I introduced her to God, anointed ministry, and she was real pleased with the message that you bought.
Amen.
And I'm sitting here looking at her, sitting on her dining room table, reading, "Let your faith be bigger than your fear."
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Say that again.
Let your faith be bigger than your fear. This is a sticker that she got on her dining room table. She's been talking about the Lord ever since I've been here. Maybe she's going to say hello to y'all. This is God, anointed hand ministry. All the ministry, Pastor Lyle, Pastor Stevenson, and Pastor Kim, and all the other ministers that's online. This is a classmate of mine, Sister Evelyn Rose.
Amen.
How you doing,
Miss
Rose?
How you doing, ma'am?
Doing great. How you doing?
We blessed.
Yeah. Better than blessed. I'm glad the farmer Jimmy let me listen to him.
Amen. Amen.
I'll be tuning in to you.
Amen. Amen. Glad to have you. Anybody else got anything to say?
This message, I enjoyed it as always.
Amen. I heard two people at once.
Because you was not trying to hear your favorite sister.
Oh, go ahead.
I was trying to be quiet about your comment about the sick first feeling.
I just had to throw that in there.
Hey, sister, don't worry about him. We won.
Yeah, I slid that in there.
Most certainly did.
Yeah, I'm only worried about the frog.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, here she go.
Yeah, that's no faith. Y'all know there was a song they used to sing all the time when I was younger, and it's been a song that stuck with me. And as I got older, I really knew what it meant. And it was "This Morning When I Rose," and it says, "I didn't have no doubt." Miss Viola Williams used to sing it. This lady at my church when I was younger, and she could go. And you know, I didn't know what the song meant as much as until I got older. Now, it caught my attention, but as I got older, I found out the reason I didn't have no doubt wasn't because of me. It was because of God. He kept waking me up. He kept giving me blessings. He kept putting me in places. He kept rescuing me. He kept being with me, even when I wasn't trying to be with him at times. And that's the reason why you should have no doubt in him, because even in my times when I was trying not to be there, he was still there. In other words, God is God all the time. And we may fall short. David fell short. Paul, anybody in that Bible, except Jesus, fell short. And God has still been there. So we shouldn't have no doubt. When we wake up, we should have no doubt. We can face anything through faith because God has been that good to us. And even if we don't wake up, we already know the answer there too, because salvation has been completed for us. It ain't something we waiting on to get paid on or he owe on. He already paid it off. So, what we doubting for? We need to stop doubting. We need to, faith can only be in confidence. Doubt is contrary to faith. Amen. Pastor Stevens, you want to pray us out?
Yes, sir.